Now, the comparison condition that we've seen so far, well, it can do more than just greater than or less than. That was just a real simple thing. So I'll go ahead and add a new comparison and show you. I'll add this as a new condition. Incidentally, when I add new conditions, each new condition is going to show up over here in this list. And then if any one of those conditions is true, then we're going to go ahead and trigger. Now, we have some capability to do ands and ors, and we'll talk about that separately. But, you know, basically, each rule that you see here, it's being approached as an or. If any one of those is true, then we'll send the notification. So let's take a look at this in more detail. First, I'll choose my input. And my input, again, is an element attribute from your target. And instead of just a simple greater than less than, let's try these string comparisons. We have string comparisons in which we can look at the value and compare it to a string. The three here are in, not in, and includes. Now let's take a look at in first. Let's say that this actually here represents the status of a controller. And what you're very worried about is if somebody, if for example the controller has a status of failed, or if somebody takes the value, or that's that controller, and puts it into a manual state. And you don't want either of those things to happen, so you want a notification. So what you're saying is, if this value is in this list, you know, then at that point we're going to go ahead and trigger the notification. You could go this a different way. If you wanted to, oh, let's say it's easier for you to specify the good states, you could go around the other way around. You could say, let's check and make sure if it's not in auto or if it's not in cascade. Yeah, there we go. So those are the two good states. If you're saying if it's not in one of those two, then that's a problem. And so we'll send a notification then. Now that last one though, the includes, this is going the other way around. It's comparing the entire string that we get here to see if this contains here, this value has a subset of this string. So for example, I'll give you a good example. I used to work at a place where one of the distillation columns would go wet. That's just basically, that's the jargon we would use when there was too much water in that column. And let's say that this value we're interrogating here is a comment from an operator. Well, what we would like to send a notification in is if any operator makes a comment that includes the word wet, or, you know, something else, wet or humid or something like that. So we're basically saying it doesn't have to be 100% match, but if at any point, you know, that right there includes wet or humid or anything else that we consider a trigger word, then that's going to, you know, that's going to be something that that we watch for and want to be notified of. So those are some of the string comparisons. Now, in addition, we have, any change just simply means that. If there's any change at all, we'll go ahead and send a notification. Now, the step decrease, increase, and change, these are step changes, meaning we need to specify, basically, if there's some kind of a change in value that's greater than or less than a certain amount. Let's say we're going to go with 5 engineering units, and that's what we're going to measure. We're measuring this in engineering units. So any step decrease larger than 5 is going to alert. Now, see the difference between that and step change larger than 5. This means, essentially, whether it's a decrease or an increase, we're really worried because something's changing much too quickly. Or if it's not changing enough, step change less than. Now, we have the same type of comparisons for rate changes. Now with a rate change, and you can find more information about this, by the way, in the notifications guide. Now, here's our notifications manual. And as you can see, we describe the step change, we describe the rate change, and exactly, you know, how we're doing this calculation. Essentially, the rate change is going to divide the current value from the previous value by the number of seconds between the two and come up with a rate per second. And if that rate is decreasing or increasing at too great a rate, then that's something you can alarm. And hey, we got that same thing we saw before. Whether it's a decrease or an increase, we can just say if the rate is changing too much, or if the rate is not changing enough, then do an alarm there. So those are some of the rate change options. Now finally, we've got this is good and is bad, and the is good is simply basically saying it's a value that we expect for the data type. So what that means is if the value of this input here is an integer or a real, by good we simply mean it is showing up as an integer or a real, not as some kind of a digital state like point created or no data or overrange or something like that. So, you know, that's what we mean by is good. Is bad would mean we're basically getting some kind of a digital state for something we anticipate to be a real or an integer. Now, if you take a look closely here, you can see when we do use this is good and is bad, we're dimming everything else out because really they don't apply at this point. It's a simple check to see if the values are coming in as reals or integers. So let's say I'm going to go ahead and do this as just a straight comparison like we did before. And to make this a little more interesting, let me go with how about less than. So we've got less than a value, and the value is going to be, let's see, I think we've got greater than 250. Let's say less than 50. By the way, as you can see, we can also specify an attribute. In the case of an attribute, now we'll go out and do the comparison to some other attribute.